So excited that you're here today. Isn't this a great place to be? Well, we are going to welcome God in this place, but one housekeeping business that we want to take care of just before we get started. We are going to be having the resolution today with our men, and we're so excited about those that have taken place or that have taken part of this celebration and this resolution to lead your families after God. And so what we need from you men is that if you have taken part of the resolution, we want to make sure that you have your tag where you checked your kids in, because your kids are going to be joining us at the end of the service, and you are going to need that tag to make sure that you can take them. And so we want to make sure you have it, so have it handy so when they come in at the end, so that we can just actively involve them in this resolution. Let's go ahead and invite God into this place. Lord Jesus, we love you, God, and we just worship you, and we are here to praise you today. So Lord God, we just invite you to just be with us, to just come and walk through these aisles and to just sit down among us, Lord, because we want to bring you all glory and all praise, because you're worthy. In your precious holy name, amen.
thirst for truth, needing hope and strength renewed. Come and meet the Savior of the world. Everyone who longs inside, desperate for the words of life, come and meet the Savior of your soul. God is with us now. His love reigns down. His love reigns down. Saved by grace and power. His love reigns down. His love reigns down. God is with us now. Everyone who lives in Christ, died to self and raised to life, come and praise the Savior of the world. Everyone who perseveres, faith will overcome all fears, come and praise the Savior of your soul. As God is with us now, His love down, His love reigns down. Saved by grace and power, His love reigns down. His love reigns down. God is with us now.
And nothing can ever separate us. God is with us now, and nothing can take His promise from us. God is with us now, and no one can take the place of Jesus. God is with us now. There's no more shame, no more fear. We are free, 'cause God is here. God is with us now. His love down, His love breaks down. Saved by grace and power, His love breaks down. His love breaks down. God is with us now. His love breaks down. His love. Why don't you go ahead and have a seat, and we're just going to turn it over to Pastor Trey and the kids.
All right. We're going to take a moment and shake hands, so I'm sorry everybody just sat down. But go ahead and stand to your feet and just give someone a hug in this church right now. Jason Beck. All right, church family, my name is Trey Wilborn. I'm the children's pastor here. For those of you guys who don't have kids, you may not know who I am. But I am thrilled to be before you today because I have something exciting to share. And it's nothing that I could say. I want to introduce four kiddos. Y'all come on up here. Yeah, y'all give them a hand. And y'all just stand right here. We just got back from kids camp. And God did some very, very powerful things at kids camp. And I had the opportunity just to speak with these guys, and they touched my heart. And so I'm not going to talk any longer. I want to just let them talk from this point forward. But my question to you is, what did God do for you at camp? And if you could just share that with the church, that would really bless us this morning. And so I'm going to start with Brittany Fernandez here. She's incredible. But Brittany, would you just take the microphone and share with us what God did for you at kids camp this year?
Well, God spoke to me in a way I didn't think he will. And it was mostly in altar time that he spoke to me. And I was just raising my hands, praying for the Holy Spirit. And I saw all the other girls crying and feeling the Holy Spirit. So I thought I had to cry and feel the Holy Spirit. So I was just praying and praying. And then Miss Amy came up to me and asked me for prayer. And I said, yeah. And so we were praying, and Miss Amy was praying about how shining your light and talking to other people about Jesus. And I just blocked everybody around me, and God really spoke to me and said that, Brittany, you're going to be a missionary one day. And he said that you're going to be an awesome missionary in somewhere you wouldn't believe. And he just told me to really change and shine my light to other people and talk to other people about Jesus and just read my Bible more and read the Bible to other people and show my love and show my light and my love to other people and my family. And
hey, you did a great job. You did a great job. Wow. It's hard to follow that act up. This is Micah Bailey. He's a leader among leaders. I don't need to say anything else. Micah, we love you. The whole church loves you. We're proud of you. But please share with us what God did for you at camp this year.
This year at camp, God really spoke to me. And he gave me, I think, the power to help talk to other kids and talk about what they're going through and pray for them. And I think that I'm going to try to use that to the best of my abilities and really try to help other kids. And I just really, really felt a bunch of powerful at camp. I can't explain it. It's just that feeling.
It's incredible. Yeah. It's incredible. Hey, man. Great job, buddy. Proud of you. And for those of you who don't know Micah, he came up to me this past week and said, Pastor Trey, I just want to help somebody in my school. I want to start some kind of club. I want to get into the school and just reach the people in my area of influence. And so that just speaks volume of his character. So we were so proud of you. So proud of you, yeah. And this is Roman. Roman. You're getting some applause from the youth section over there. Roman, he is incredible. This past week at camp, or 2 weeks ago, however long it's been now, his light did shine. And he was participating in the altars, and he was really seeking after what God was speaking to him. He didn't miss an opportunity, and so he came back with a fire in him. And I just want to give you the chance to share that with the church. Roman, what did God do for you at camp this year?
I built my relationship with the Lord when I went to camp, and I really felt the Holy Spirit in my heart. And I, kind of like Micah, I felt like I wanted to help a lot of other kids build their relationship with the Holy Spirit. So.
That's good. Hey. Woo! It's a great job. Hey, we're so proud of you, Roman. We really are. Most of you know this guy right here, Jaron Taylor. This was his last year at camp, and he helped me more than you know, lead the group and help me where I couldn't be there. So I'm proud of you for that. But Jaron, could you just share with the church here what God did for you at camp this year?
Well, as I was down at the altars, I felt the Holy Spirit come up on me, and He just started to talk to me, and like Roman and Micah, I felt that same thing that they felt. And after our second service there, we went back to our cabin and we started to talk about what God was doing in our lives. And I said, well, I feel like God is building me to be a man of God and building me in His image so that I can go and share His word with other people around the world. And I feel like that's what He needs me to do, since most of my friends at school, they don't know God and they just don't know His word. They say they read the Bible, they say they're Christian, but I can see that in their heart that they're just bad people. And so I really feel like God is like telling me to go to school and share to them about His word in the Bible.
The children don't always get a chance to come over here and be part of the services, but I can assure you that our church is raising a group of world changers. I know that it takes these type of men and women right here, although they're not fully grown yet, I know God is going to just work very powerfully in their life. And I speak on behalf of the church, seriously, we are so proud of you guys. We know that you have a calling, we know that you have a future, but just don't veer off the straight and the narrow path. Always stay close to the Lord, and we know that you guys will do incredible things. So let's just give it up one more time for the kiddos.
Wow. Let's just praise God because He's good, isn't He?
No bounds, your goodness never stops, your mercy follows me, your kindness fills my life, your love amazes me, and I sing because you are good, and I dance because you are good, and I shout because you are good, you are good. Only reflect this truth, and in my You are good to me. And I sing because you are good, and I dance because you are good, and I shout because you are good. You are good to me. With a cry of praise, my heart will proclaim, you are good. You are good. And in the sun or rain, my life celebrates. You are good. You are good. With a cry of praise, my heart will proclaim. You are good. You are good. With the sun or rain, my life celebrates. You are good, you are good. And I sing because you are good, and I dance because you are good, and I shout because you are good to me. And I sing because you are good, and I dance because you are good, and I shout because you are good. You are good, good to me. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Hallelujah. Oh, you're good. You are so good, God. Of all that you've done, and the life I have because of your Son. Love came down and rescued me. Love came down and set me free. And I am yours. I am forever yours. Mountain high, comes my way when I feel your hands of grace rest upon me. Staying desperate for you, God, staying humbled at your feet, I will lift these hands in praise. I will believe. I'll remind myself of all that you've done, and the life I have because of your Son. Oh, love came down and rescued me. Love came down and set me free. And I am yours. I am forever yours. Mountain high or valley low, I sing out, remind my soul. I am forever yours.
Jesus.
Jesus Christ, take my life, take all of me. Is in you, Jesus Christ, take my life, take all of me. And I love you so, and I all my life to say I need you so. And all to Jesus I surrender, all to Him I freely give. I will never love and trust Him in His presence daily live. And I surrender all, I surrender all to Thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender. To Jesus I surrender, Lord, I give myself to Thee. Fill me with Thy love and power. Let Thy blessings fall on me. To Thee,
time to surrender our hearts.
And I surrender all. I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all.
Thank you, Jesus. Father, I pray that is the desire of our hearts today. We have a lot of important things happening in our life, of which you know very clearly what those things are. But I also believe you give us scripture. If we'll listen and we'll trust you, you always know what's best. You understand what we need, and you care. So today I ask, Holy Spirit, open the door of our hearts if necessary. Break up the hardness of our heart, till the soil of our heart, whatever necessary, so that your word could be like seed planted in fertile soil. Water it, tend it, let your word come forth, and the fruit of your word become the fruit of our life. God, we need you, and we need you to speak to us, and so in our obedience, we surrender to you. Not just the busyness of our day, but the purpose of our heart. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Everyone say with me, amen. 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 Give God praise. As the lights are coming up, would you please shake somebody's hand? Get your Bible ready and turn to Matthew chapter 6. I'd like to welcome all of you here to Faith this morning. If it's your first time here as our guest, obviously, you've hopefully been welcomed, but let me personally say we're glad that you're here. We'd love to learn a little bit about you, so there is a form in the back of your pew if you'd like to fill that out. Give us that information. Let us know where you're from, what's happening in your life, and how we can help and serve in helping you in your thriving relationship with Jesus Christ. What was mentioned before service is that those of you who signed up and have been participating with me in the Resolution for Men in the last couple of weeks. You may have missed 1 week. That's okay. But if you have attended these sessions with me and are going to participate in our ceremony following the service, we'll be mindful of everybody's time. We've asked God to help us by His grace, communicate what needs to be communicated, and let us honor you before your families with the resolution that you're now setting. I want you to secure your ticket here. This is the ticket I have for my children. I want you to secure this and put it in your pocket. Be sure it's quick to get to, because after this service, at the end, we're going to invite all of you men down here that have been participating in this, and we have your plaques and your certificates and all of that. And we are also going to ask the families to join you, because you're going to be speaking to your family as you resolve today, by God's grace, to do what He's called you to do, and your children will join you. So that ticket will allow our children's pastor to give me a thumbs up when we have all our children secure and where they need to be. If that's okay with you, please say okay. Those of you that are unconcerned, say okay. That's what I thought, half and half. Just those who come up, your children will join you, okay? The rest, please go across the parking lot. Your children will be having fun in their regular scheduled service times. Are you with me? Praise God. Those of you online, it's me and you today. It's just me and you. We're like this. Turn to Matthew chapter 6. We began a series entitled Guardrails several weeks back. You're wondering, how many more weeks of this, Pastor? This week and next week. We're going to wrap this thing up next week. And it's been a fantastic illustration of how God can set a personal standard in our life if we'll let Him. A system of guardrails, basically the definition of it is basically designed to keep vehicles. We know what guardrails are. They're on the edge of the road. That's to keep vehicles from straying, that's our key word, or wandering into dangerous areas. And so what we've done is we've talked about, you know, these invisible guardrails in our life, and we began to ask a question. Well, what if, you know, those guardrails on the road, you know, I always draw a line right here. I hope you can see the guardrail. You see that guardrail with me? This guardrail is basically here to keep me from veering or straying over the cliff into the danger area or into the ditch, so to speak, on the side of the road. So these guardrails are normally placed where we drive. They're normally not placed, although there are exceptions, they're normally not placed right on the edge. A guardrail is usually placed in a safe zone. Therefore, you could go beyond that guardrail and still be okay, but what we don't want to happen is that you have to figure that out. Because many times in life, a lot of Christians, not at this church, but in other places, in other states, they like to walk the line and ask, am I sinning or am I not sinning? Is this a sin or not? I've got one foot in, I've got one foot out. And that's not how we want to live. That's not what God did. He didn't give his son so that we could live on the edge trying to decide in our own moral compasses, is this a sin or is this not a sin? The Bible's very, very clear and gives us very, very stated, if you will, principles to live by, doesn't it? The Word of God is our truth. The Word of God, the psalmist says, this is our lamp into our feet and the light into our path. If you want to know what to do in life, you really don't have to go Google that. You can actually go right here and God will speak to you of his truth. God is the author and he is the finisher of our faith. He is the beginning and he is the end. He was and will be, okay? And so I say all of this as we call him the Alpha and the Omega for a reason. He was here before you and he'll be here after you. But the idea is seek him and he will give you the wisdom that you need to be successful in this life. And what we've done is we've talked about these guardrails that are usually found on bridges, usually found on dangerous sharp curves, or usually found in between oncoming traffic, because the key word is they're there to stop you at best from going over the cliff of despair, going over the cliff of hardship. And so we decided to set our own definition of a guardrail. And if you like to take notes, write this down. It's a standard of behavior that you choose that becomes a matter of conscience. A standard of behavior that you choose that becomes a matter of conscience. Now, here's the deal. I've been approached on more than one occasion. Pastor, that's a dangerous kind of statement to make. You're saying that I get to set my own guardrails and I get to choose on my own moral standards what is right and what is wrong. Yes and no. I believe we are free moral agents, correct? God gives you a will. God gives you your own mind to think. He also gives you the absolute truth. And if he says, do not cross this line, hello, I don't want you to make that line your guardrail. And here's why. Because we talked about this, all right? We talked about drinking. We've talked about sex. We've talked about our finances. We've talked about some big issues, right? All of us would agree, most of our deepest regrets, if we had just had a guardrail to hit before we hit the line of no return, we would have been better off. So the idea here is, if God says, don't cross this line, it's clearly stated in the Bible, don't cross this line, we need to come on the inside of his principle, on the safe side of that, and say, as a moral of conscious response, I want to set a personal standard here today, that if I get close to the line of no return, I want to hit something that makes me respond on the inside. So if you do struggle with drinking, the Bible says don't get drunk on wine. Everybody wants to make the drinking the sin. God says the drinking's not a sin. So hear me. Debauchery is. Keep reading. Debauchery is the sin. That's the line of no return. He says don't do anything. No desire. No relationship. No investment. No drinking. No drug. No this. No that. Whatever it is that will take you to a place of losing your self-control is debauchery. So if that's the line, you set a personal standard right here. Wouldn't it be nice to hit that guardrail and have to deal with a little bit of fender damage than to tumble over the cliff of relational despair, financial despair, hello, emotional despair? That's what this series is all about. I want to give handles to this truth that God will set a principle, and I want you to move on the inside of that principle, and you begin to set personal standards in your own life. On the inside of his principle, all right, that when you get close to that line, something happens on the inside, and you respond. We call it the conviction of the Holy Spirit. Many of you felt it, and you're like, why do I feel so bad? And like, Paul, why do I always do what I don't want to do, and I always don't do what I need to do, and I just am living in this cloud of confusion? Well, standards. If you've got your Bible, Matthew chapter 6, go there with me. Matthew chapter 6. I want to hear what Jesus has to say when it comes to this one particular item. We've talked, you know, I think, just be real clear, most of our regrets, I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand, I'm not going to ask you to poke your neighbor, I'm not going to ask you to turn red in your face. Don't reveal anything, all right? Most of us in here, if given the chance to say yes or no, would probably say yes, that one of your biggest regrets, if not the biggest regret that you've carried the weight of in this life, has either dealt with sex or money. Don't shake your head. No, go, you listening? Don't do that. It's just true. Most of our biggest regrets deal between one of those two areas. 90%, I would say. We've already talked about sex, intimacy, and all of that, and you should get that DVD or whatever and just see what God has to say about all of that and the guardrails that we can set. They're powerful guardrails. But today I want to talk to you about your money and your finances. You're like, I knew it. He gets the resolution going for the men that brings all the family in the church. They don't, I want your money, and they don't want you to have sex. Well, no, that's not true. That's not true. But I do want to share with you what the Bible says. And in Matthew chapter 6, this is how Jesus addresses this. Because look, God's number one contender for your heart. Listen very closely. Write this down. God's number one contender for your heart, right? It's not the devil. We give him way too much credit. It's your stuff. It's your things. It's your stuff. Because the money that we get, we are a consuming nation. Man, I've got some stories to tell in just a minute. You'll relate to them. God isn't really struggling with you against the devil half the time. He's struggling with you for the contention and the desire of your heart, because we have access to so much stuff. And we need to talk about this today. So I want you to write that down, that the number one contender for your heart isn't always the enemy. It very well could be your stuff. And this is what Jesus says about that, because he's got a lot to say about it. Matthew chapter 6, verse 24 says this: no one can serve two masters. Very familiar verse. Most of you even know this. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You can't serve both God and what? Why did he put that word? You could have put 100,000 different words in there, all right? He put God and money. So you can't serve both. Reason for that is because, and all of us have felt it, there is a tension within the two. When it comes to who's going to be the master of your life, there is a tension between God and your stuff, or the money that your stuff, that purchases your stuff. You'll tend to place your trust in and thus be the servant of, and thus be, you know, allowed to be the master in your life, the money or the pursuit of wealth or the pursuit of security or whatever that represents to you, or God. And here's how we're going to look at it. We're going to look at it two different ways. And the reason why I want you to understand this is because God's chief competitor is not Satan, it's our consumption of stuff. And the two areas I want you to write in your notes is this: consumption and hoarding. What? Consumption and hoarding. This is how this works. We can break it down into two different ways. The consumption factor, right? Everything that comes in, everything that you make, every dollar that you make, you begin to consume it. It is consumed in your home, in your car, in your stuff, in your toys, in your hobbies. You have a tendency to fall into consumer debt. And that's probably a number of us in here today, and I am as transparent as it can be, and I'm putting this thing together. I'm laughing at myself because I am so in this. You understand? I am with everybody in this, and it's speaking just as clear to me as it's speaking to you, I hope. Consumerism, consumer debt. There's the consuming side of our finances, and then there's the hoarding. The hoarding is the what-if syndrome. It's the what-if I get sick? What if the economy crashes again? What if the housing market goes down? What if I lose my job? What if I this? What if I that? And what about Y2K? What about the Mayan calendars? We're not even talking about that anymore. What about? And basically what this means is and here's the irony. Usually, the consumer and the hoarder get married in other places. And that's where it gets fun, right? But here's the fact. We don't call it consumer and hoarder in marriage. What do we call it? Spenders and savers. All right. But here's the problem. Both are self-centered. Both leave you living as though there is no God. I'm going to get like right down, just, I got to just speak the truth today. I can't just flower this thing up. Both are consumed with greed. Write it down. You can't see greed in the mirror. So Jesus, throughout his ministry, addresses this issue for us. I find it interesting. It's not in my notes, but I think Jesus is wearing a toga and, like, sandals. He didn't have to worry about, like, the Gucci and the Duniberg for the ladies and whatever else y'all think is really hip and all that, the rock star jeans and the buckle this and the this and that. He had a tunic and he had sandals. And he's talking to them in a meaningful way as he's talking to us today. You can't serve two masters. You can't serve me and your money. I don't care how fashionable your tunic is or how cool your sandals are or whatever. There are consumers and there are savers. Or would you rather me say it this? Consumers consume now. Savers save for me later. You can see it's a selfish thing. The consumer is, I'm going to consume because it's mine to consume today. And the saver or the hoarder is like, I'm going to shove it all aside because it's for me tomorrow. Again, the root of this is selfishness. The root of this is greed. This leaves you living as if there's no God, and I'll make sense of this in just a second. Doesn't mean that you don't believe in God. It doesn't mean that you don't believe that He can care for you. It just means that your number one focus, your number one tension point in your life is the financial situation that you're now in. The financial situation. Where's it going to leave me tomorrow? If you're asking these questions about your finances, you need to think about this. Where's this going to leave me financially? Am I going to be able to get what I want? Am I going to be able to leverage this to have more for tomorrow? Am I going to be able to save enough for the future? All of these are wonderful questions. All of these are wonderful questions. But if that's your chief concern, depending on and relying on your income and your finances and your finances alone, ultimately that means you're fueled by the G word, greed. Y'all get quiet. If you're fueled by greed, this means you live as if there is no God. You got to just take a deep breath with me. Do Mr. Miyagi thing. Breathe out. One more time for me. Breathe out. Okay, you feel better? This is what I know about greedy people. Feel like you got it all together, your finances are set, and you got it all together, and you call it a blessing and so forth, but this is what happens with greedy people. As soon as you hit a bump in your fiscal or financial plan or whatever, you hit a roadblock. I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand if you've ever hit a roadblock in your finances or dealing with finances with family, kids, whatever, these circumstances that you can't, it's called uncategorized spending in your budgets, okay? Because I know, I'm with you. If you've ever run into a snag, who do you run to? You're not running to pastor, that's for sure. And you're not probably going to your mom. We run to God, don't we? We run to Him for our financial woes, our hiccups, our financial situations. And let me explain. I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand, but I want to know, how many of you have ever run to God with a financial issue? So raise your hand. I'm going to ask you anyways. I have. I'm the first one. I'm going to put two hands up. Those of you who have never raised your hand because you had a financial question, concern, or whatever, I'm praying for you. Because an average person lies 17 times a day. I heard that fact. I don't know if that was a Google fact or not. I'm praying. I think all of us, most all of us, have asked God for wisdom, help within our concern for our finances. And here's why. Because God often becomes a backup plan in this part of our life. How do I explain that? God, I love you, but would you hang out right here? I'm going to be doing this, and all is well. I'm healthy. My mind is clear. I'm thinking clearly. I am reading your word. I am spreading your gospel, but God, I need you right there. I'm making my money, and I'm doing my thing, and I'm fiscally sound. I got it under control, therefore I'm healthy. God, thank you for the blessing. I'm good. But as soon as you hit that wall, you got, ooh. Now, hi, remember me, I'm Jason. We prayed once or twice before over this, but I need your help. I don't know how I'm going to pay the bill. I don't know how I'm going to get my child out of the emergency room and be able to live. You know, I don't know if I'm going to be able to put food. I don't know if you've ever asked any of these questions, but I know God's heard them all. You know, I think we're known for this. We jump out of bed. We run, we brush our teeth. We get cleaned up, hopefully most of you. Put some deodorant on, and you go outside, and you eat your breakfast, and you go to work. You tackle your day, you got your to-do list, and at the end of the day, you pray and you say, God, thank you for helping me accomplish everything that I set my heart to. Praise God. But did you ask him, God, what do you want me to do today? How do you want me to be a steward of these finances? How do you want me to speak to my friends? How do you want me to carry my attitude today at work? God, please stay right there until I need you. This is what I share with our staff. This is what I have to do. This is what your pastor has to do every single day. I tell you this, and if you go through the grid or the life flow, I say, before my feet touches the ground, what does your pastor do? He pleads the blood of Jesus over himself and his family, and he arms himself with the armor of God. Today, God, before my feet touch the ground, I want to represent the gospel of peace, not somebody else's idea. God, I want to have the belt of truth, your truth, not my truth. I need the breastplate of righteousness, the helmet of salvation, the sword of the Spirit, and the shield of faith. I cannot take my first step until I'm fully clothed in what you say is righteousness. It's not me. And now listen, I tell you this, and look, the reason I do this is because I know I'm an idiot in here sometimes. Amen? Wait a minute. It's okay. I receive it. But here's the deal. I will go through my day. Okay, it is good. I will go through my day, and here's the truth. Many, many times at the end of my day, I'll sit down and go, God, wasn't that good? You're so good to me. Look at what I did. And I often wonder how many times you're sitting there going, wow, it could have been so much better. But I love you anyways, and I know you, and I know your heart, so I'm not disappointed in you. But I sure would like to have a little space in your busy schedule so that I can help you with some of these things. Many of us in our financial decisions, our financial woes, we run to God when our problem occurs. We haven't run to God before our problem occurs. I think there are a lot of people in marriage, they want to come back and what is the saying? They plan not to fail, but they don't plan to succeed. So many times I find myself running back to God, and this is your pastor. Here I am today, I need your help. I need your wisdom. So I need you to speak into me, because a lot of people are going to be affected by this decision. I'd rather have that decision on the safe side of the guardrail than on the other side of the guardrail. I'd rather know what he's saying here than over there and have to be climbing back out. This is one of those guardrails that's a two-system thing. You've got a ditch on one side, and you've got a ditch on the other. This is the consumption side, and this is the hoarding side. God, I need to know what it is, because I have got to break within me the spirit of greed. I know this is not what you expected to hear about the finances, because some of y'all have been saving for a long, long time, and you're givers, but I want to ask you a question. If you stay up at night worried about your dollars, worried about your investments, worried about if you're going to have enough or if this is going to be good enough or whatever, I'm telling you, I'd rather you hear from the Word. Here's what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 6, 21. It says, for where your treasure is, what does it say? There your heart will be also. Okay, so here, how do we deal with this? And we're going to get to this point. How do we deal with this? I'm going to give you a little system, and this is something that I tested on my kids, and there are test dummies. You know that, right? God gives you kids so they can be test dummies, and you can, anyways. Three jars. We don't have the jars set up yet, but I went to my son yesterday, and I wanted to know if I've been doing a good job as a parent, because all of us want to know. And I said, son, what are you doing? He goes, I'm looking online, because I'm going to buy some stuff. Didn't you just, like, take a shower, because you just mowed, and you didn't have any money until you mowed? It was $10. I didn't even have time to give you your money. He goes, I know. But I got $10, and I can get two games for $10. Or I could get three games for $10.50. I haven't really decided yet if I want three games or if I want two games, but this is right here. I'm so excited I'm going to buy these things. I'm like, son, what do we talk about? When you get money, what do? You give. You saw my son talking earlier, and he goes, you give. Then what?
You save.
Then what? Yes. And we really haven't talked about all the percentage stuff. But the idea is, what matters is first. What's first? It's the first thing that comes to your mind. And my kids are just like their dad and their mom. We get excited when money comes in. We're like, praise God, what can we do with the money? Or the consumer side. We're not hoarders. That's bad. We consume. So my kids, they have our DNA, and they just they mow, and his hair's not even dry from the shower yet, and he's online. He's spending money he didn't even have. I'm sorry. I just got to tell it. Here's the deal. I don't want my kids to ever be owned by what they own. Write it down. I don't want you to be owned by what you own. Man, that is a truth. If you're not careful, the things, the stuff, the consumption of every dollar, your worry at night can be controlled by your stuff. And here's where it kind of really gets down to it. The idea of financial freedom is just simply this: living your life without having to serve your money. That's financial freedom. Living your life so you don't have to serve your money because of the consumption of stuff, that debt that's looming over your head because you got to sit at home every week and you can't do the things you know you'd like to do for your family or give or support or do these other things because you're locked in, oppressed by this weight. Matthew chapter 6, verse 24. No one can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You can't serve both God and money. If we were to continue going down to verse 31, it says this: so don't worry. Isn't that nice that God would just put that in there? Don't worry, saying, what shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or what shall we wear? Apparently back then, they had the same worries we do. Their dialogue hasn't changed over 2,000 years. I don't know if I'm going to be able to buy school clothes for the kids. I don't know if I'm going to be able to get the new, the ladies, you break your heel, and you're like, oh, I don't know if I can get a new set of heels. Well, Payless is great. You're getting like the twofer. What do you do, the bungo? I'm sorry, did I say that? I'm just kidding. We pay big dollars for our shoes. We're consumers. We're not hoarders. And I keep reading. How can we get to where this is not an issue in our life? Where we're not sitting up at night worried about a green piece of paper with somebody's head on it, you'll never meet them. Paper. We're worried. How many days, nights, hours, minutes, months have you worried sick over paper? That was what was just going through my heart while I'm mine. Verse 32, the first part of that verse 32 in chapter 6 says this: for the pagans run after these things, all these things. What? Now, nobody likes to be called a pagan. But just let me tell you what a pagan is. A pagan is anybody that's of the world and not of God. Not in relationship with God. Living like the world. That's what a pagan is. So if you're staying up at night, this is how God's speaking to me. I'm staying up at night. I'm worried about paper. I'm worried about bills. I'm worried about purchases, or how am I going to get this to work? And I'm massaging the numbers, and I'm budgeting my numbers, and I'm doing all that I possibly can, but I've stayed up half the night worried about it. He said, you know what? You're living just like a pagan lives. You're greedy. You're worried about the consumption of every single dollar that comes into your hand. And why? Because, well, first of all, we need to see what else he has to say. You with me? The second part of the verse says this. Here, just understand this. If that's how you're living, that's how the pagans live. They run after all these things. But this is what I love about God. He says, and your heavenly Father, circle this, highlight this, whatever you got to do. Your heavenly Father knows that you need them. Hold on a second. So I am worried probably about the right things. But God says he knows that you need them. What is this? What is all this? What is this? Messing with us emotionally. The reason we worry is because we're really not convinced, probably, that God knows that we need these things or that he cares. Why else would you worry? Right? I mean, if God is who he says he is, right? He's the author and the finisher of our faith. He's the first and the last. He doesn't deal with money. He doesn't worry about the money. We're talking life stuff. This is God, the creator, who spoke the stars and the sun that we get to enjoy every day and so forth. This is God. And he says, you know what? I know you need these things. How does that set into your heart? Put that in the perspective of last night if you were up worried all night long about your finances, worried about all this saving or consuming. You don't have to be rich to be greedy. You could be poor and greedy, because if you're poor and you're still worried about all your money, or you're rich and still worried about all your money and your investments and this and that, it's selfishness, and selfishness is the fuel of greed. And that's why Jesus said, you can't serve me and that. You're going to have to choose. Do you think God knows or cares about you paying your bills? Do you think God cares whether or not, if it's a desire of your heart to send your kids to college and help them in that way? Do you think he cares about that? Do you think he cares, you know, if you lived your life in such a way that you wanted to have integrity? Of course he does. He says, I know you need these things. I know the desires of your heart. So we have to continue reading to understand this as it unfolds. That's Jesus' promise. In verse 33, he says this. This is how all this happens. Seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these, what? Things will be given to you as well. That's the promise Jesus makes. What is it? Is it the things? Is that the hinge point? Is it the stuff? Is that what he's really wanting you to gather out of that verse? Does he really go to the cross so that he could stand before you and go, just, here's how you can get your things? No. What's first? What's first? Seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. We give, we save, and we spend. Your church loves God, loves people, and loves life. We give, we save, and we spend. You know why we do these things, right? We want to put God first. Love me with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, with all your might. Love your neighbor as yourself. This is the second command. Then, John 10:10, you will have life and life to the full. Even in your finances. What is it? You know, that Dave Ramsey thing is so crazy. You know, if you've ever seen, I'm not saying he's got the corner on the market, but he's got some great illustrations to help you understand your finances. If you were to open your hand like this and sand were to be poured into your hand, you could pile that sand up more than you could hold like this, right? You would just kind of see it kind of going like this. Sure, some of it would go out, but you'd still have a whole handful. But the day you grip that joker, all of that overflow begins to fall out somewhere else, and you're left with just what you could hold. And God's saying, seek first, Mike. He says, go ahead, find a percentage that suits your heart as I've loved you. Love me in obedience. Find a percentage. We like to call it 10% to start with around here. You're asking, why, Pastor, why do you always say we're going to give our tithes and our offering? Tithe is a tenth. It's the first fruits. It's the first part. Why are we doing that first? Because we give, then we save, and then we live. Does that make sense? We give, we save, we live. We love God, we love people, and we love life. And that's how we do this, because of the biblical principle here. There's guardrails we want to set. If we invert those things, we could become selfish. And selfishness is the fuel to greed. And we need to break the spirit of greed in our life. If we're ever going to have the fulfillment that we're looking for in this life, it's through him. Seek first his kingdom. First, then, because he knows the things you need. Then these things also will be added to you. Praise God. All right. What's first? He is. What does your pastor do every day? The first thing he does? Carve space for God. Let me just help you with this. Ephesians 6. Before your feet touch the ground, Ephesians 6. It's not on the notes, but this is what I do. Ephesians 6. Brush my teeth, because that's good. And then I go to my office, or wherever I find a comfortable place, and I do my reading. I want to see where my feet are now going to walk. The lamp into my feet and light into my path. I read. My wife would love for me to greet her first, but ask her. I come after I have been in the presence of God so that I can carry that love with me. By myself, I'm not half the man I know I need to be for her. Hello? On my own wisdom, I can't make the decisions I need to make financially for my home, for my kids. I can't. I have to give God that time. I have to give him space. And the only time I can do that is at the beginning of my day. Because I find that if I come back door at the end and then I ask him, well, then now I got to ask him for help all of those things along the way. I'm going to seek first everything that's come to me. Everything. My son. We had to seek first the kingdom of God because we couldn't hold him. Because they took him to the NICU. The minute he came out of my wife's person. They handed me that child. He turned purple. I wanted her to hold him. But God said no. And we had to come to a place. And I was humorous. But listen, we had to come to a place where God, in our heart, had the right to that child before we did. I'm just saying that's how I have to roll. And when I gave that child to God, and I said, if you want to loan him to me, I'll raise him the best of my ability. He'll get to go to kids' camps and do these different things, and he'll seek you at those altars because he'll understand what the meaning of it. He'll learn the whole give, save, and live and all of that stuff because that's my commitment. But it starts first. It starts first with giving God the first. Everything in your life, your money, your relationships, all of it, you got to give God your first. Every bit of it. And he'll redeem. Stand with me, please. I will say this before we pray. I don't have the stats in front of me. You can find them on your own. This world is a great need. There's a lot of people who have great need. If those Christians that are professed Christian, saved by Jesus Christ, would just follow that principle of percentage giving first, saving a percentage you choose, and then living on the rest. You do those things that way because of how the Bible says, seek first the kingdom of God, and then these other things, which he knows and cares about, will be added to you. The world wouldn't have need. And you think that's crazy. But if just those professed Christians that are out there would give, if just those would give, there wouldn't be a water problem in Africa. You know that, right? We're talking billions of dollars. Billions of dollars. But Pastor, we have lights and the air's on every week. Yes, praise God for that. But even our church, we are not near the capacity of what God could do through us. And I'm not down on that. I'm just saying what an opportunity for God to celebrate through us our obedience. Even if one of you decides to leave here today to practice the give, the save, and live, it would change everything because it starts with you. That's what we're going to do. Dear Heavenly Father, I love you. With our heads bowed and our eyes closed, we've humbled ourselves before you. Jesus, you're very clear in your scripture. We know where our treasure is, where our heart is. And Father, I know you said you are fully aware of the needs we have in our life. So God, help us as we have courage to stand before you. Help us. Help us see you as a God that is absolutely here and now. If we could just trust you before we leave today, then these things won't be the issue anymore. Our biggest issue will be, God, how can I create time for you? How can I give that first part of my day to you? And it's not because I fear you. It's because, God, I know how effective and how meaningful that can be for my life. And I don't ever want to go back. I need you first. Then I can love those I need to love. Then I can make great decisions. I can be an incredible employee and have an attitude that inspires people instead of runs people out. I could actually come in with positive, effective, meaningful ideas because God, your Holy Spirit, would inspire me to do so. All of these are a gift for anybody I know that wants to just give you the first. Because these are the things I want in my life. And I know you're aware of those things, but I have to trust you. If you're here today, every head bowed, every eye closed, really unsure of why you're here, other than maybe you came with family for this resolution thing that's about to take place. But God's knocked on your heart. I'm just going to tell you, it wasn't the music and it's not this message. God says he'll draw all men into himself through his Spirit, his Holy Spirit. And Jesus is the only way to the Father. That means if God has knocked on your heart and you're willing to open up your heart, what you're doing is you're inviting Jesus in. And when that happens, God says you have access to him. Absolute access to him for an eternity where now you begin to build your relationship. If you're here today and the Holy Spirit's been knocking on your heart and you just can't leave today without knowing who Jesus is, will you raise your hand and say, Pastor, pray that prayer with me. Every head bowed, every eye closed. And lift it high so I know that you're not just worshiping God. There's a few of you. Lift them high. Give you a few more minutes here. I love this part of the service because God always speaks to his advantage. He always builds his kingdom through whatever we do. And I thank God for that. If you raised your hand, and everybody in this building, please say this prayer with me. Dear Jesus, thank you for loving me and seeing in me what I couldn't see for myself. I'm not perfect, but I can be forgiven. And you're the forgiver. Please forgive me. Come into my heart. I invite Jesus to live in me, that I might have access to you, Father, forever. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. We got to give God praise because the Word of God says, when one of you says that prayer, heaven rejoices. So there's like this huge party going on upstairs. One day we're going to get to experience that. This is what we're going to do. I've got to just say a prayer of blessing over those of you that are in a situation where you're now considering, am I a consumer or am I a saver? And we're one of two, one or both maybe. What we need to do is this, not be down on ourselves. What we need to do is say, now God, establish some healthy guardrails in my life. Okay? If I am a spender, when I get to a certain place in my finances, please let me hit the guardrail before I go over the cliff and start spending money that's not mine. Please, God, please, God, please. And surround me, God, with people that will encourage me to do so. Amen? If you are that ultimate savior and you're up all night worried about what you're going to have at the end of the day, say, God, give me peace that's yours. Give me an understanding, God, that what I put over there is out of my hands. It's in your hands. And let me live free of this greed, so that I can think clearly and I can move my life forward in your presence. Heavenly Father, we just stand in your presence and we know there's two sides to this road. We all fit somewhere and we don't need to be frustrated with that, but we don't need to be consumed or led by greed. I ask God in your power with your spirit, if the spirit of greed is at work in any of our lives, we would determine today that God, you have permission to break that cycle within us. Therefore, we need to seek you to fill the gap. We need to seek you for understanding to drive inside these guardrails. When we get close to the line, God, help us on the inside. Red flags go up spiritually. We need to understand in our consciousness something needs to change. Don't let us go over that cliff anymore. Don't let us have to claw our way back after years and years and years. Help us understand today the value of this. Teach us to give, to save, and to live. In Jesus' name I pray. And everyone said amen. 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 Here's the deal. I need you to all have a seat right where you're at. I took all of the time. We are honored that there are some men among us today that are resolving to be men of resolution. I want to invite all of those men that have joined me for the last couple of weeks to hurry to the front. Please, please, please come quickly right now. Come all the way up here to the front and just go across this altar. Time is not the issue. You being here is. Friends and family that have come to support these gentlemen, what I'm going to ask you to do is hold for just one moment. We have our children standing in the hallway, just the children of these men. The rest of our kids are still where they're normally going to be, so please pick those up later. Pastor Trey, would you please let the children come in and find their dad? Gentlemen, if you have your ticket, present it. Hey, guys. Good looking crew. Everybody accounted for? Can we get kiddos here that need to... Okay. All right. While a few more are coming over, if you're a spouse of one of these men, not if you want to be, because they're all handsome, if you are the spouse and family, please come, and I want you to just kind of gather in front of them so that you can see them. Come on up, please. This is very, very important to our men. The work that they've done, the work that they plan to do, and they need your support. Some of us are single men with a great plan. Some of us are single fathers. Some of us are grandparents. Some of us are our quivers full. I just, standing before you as a group of men that I just want to honor today. I want you to understand that we're not perfect. We're just going to wait a couple more seconds here for some more children. These men joined me in watching a movie a couple of weeks ago, and it was a manly effort at first, but we all left crying. Well, I did. We talked about it last week. We asked some tough questions, and some of these questions, I'll let you know, had a lot to do with our father figures in life. A lot of our men had wonderful fathers. A lot of our men didn't have a father present in their life, and some of them had some knucklehead fathers. This is truth. And we all have to process and live life, don't we? We got to make it. And these men have had some tough decisions to make through life. They've had some easy decisions to make through life. But we're all responsible for who we are and what we represent in our home. And I'm just honored to stand with these guys today. Some tough questions last week. I know it was difficult. At first we'd ask, you know, what did you connect your relationship with God the Father with how you were raised at home with your father? And I can tell you this, really couldn't talk about it with some of our men. There was some stuff that they had to deal with before they could really talk about it. So I knew God was at work. I knew there's some powerful truth happening. I knew God's grace was on our men. And I knew this is just the beginning. How are we doing with our children? They're coming. Thank you for your patience. This felt like it was just really, really important that our little ones have an opportunity to hear from Daddy today. Boy, I'm fixing to... Go stand by your mother. Good, great. How we doing? All right. Got a few more coming in here. Fantastic. Did you have your kids yet? They're coming. So we're good? Okay. Praise God. All right. You know, the Word of God speaks in Joshua 24. As far as me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. And these men have taken a few hours of their time. This is just the beginning. Small groups will be beginning here next week on Monday. If you're interested in that, obviously Mike Cooper, raise your hand. Wave it. Where are you at? Mike can assist you in getting you plugged into that. I'll be at his house. But this is a very, very serious thing. As the resolution is not a promise of perfection, it is a promise of direction. These men aren't perfect, but they do promise to set a direction today that's going to change not only them, who they are as a man and as a man of God, but as a father and as a future father, as a husband, as a co-worker, and so forth. Gentlemen, are you ready to make this commitment before God and your family today? If so, say, I will. All right, so you got to let them hear it from the inside, all right? You can't be like, I will. We're men, you ready? So if so, say, I will. Fantastic. I'm going to ask you to repeat after me in just a moment. God's word shows us that God's desire for every man is to courageously step up, and every father to do whatever it takes to be involved in the lives of his children. More than just being there for them or providing for them, he is to walk with them through their young lives and to be a visible visual representation of the character of God, our Father in heaven. Gentlemen, please repeat after me. I do solemnly resolve before God to take full responsibility for myself, my wife, my children. I will love them, protect them, serve them, teach them the Word of God as the spirit leader of my home. I will be faithful to my wife, to love and honor her, be willing to lay down my life for her as Jesus Christ did for me. I will bless my children, teach them to love God with all of their hearts, all of their minds, all of their strength. And I will train them to honor authority and to live responsibly. I will confront evil, pursue justice, and love mercy. I will pray for others and treat them with kindness, respect, and compassion. I will work diligently to provide for the needs of my family. I will forgive those who have wronged me and reconcile with those I have wronged. I will learn from my mistakes, repent of my sins, walk with integrity as a man answerable to God. I will learn from my mistakes, like I just did. I'm going to go to the next line. I got all excited. Sorry. I will seek to honor God, be faithful to His church, obey His word, and do His will. I will courageously work with the strength God provides to fulfill this resolution for the rest of my life, for His glory. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Those are powerful words, but those are just words spoken until we flesh those out every single day of our life as a token of our commitment to resolve to this measure of manhood in our life. These gentlemen have purchased a representation of that in writing that they'll be signing in just a moment. They'll sign it. They'll place it in whatever packaging they decided to place it in. They'll take a picture with their family to always remember that this is the day that they so solemnly resolved to be a better man of God, to set a clear direction in their home. After that, you're to post it somewhere visible in your house. Can I just say this to the ladies that have joined and accompanied their spouse? This is not an easy thing. Our men have given you permission to read that list and to just bring it up when it's necessary. These are guardrails in our lives. On the safe side of that cliff we don't ever want to go across. Relationally, financially, spiritually. Please honor the man in your life by being familiar with these words that he's spoken and now is resolving to live. You have permission in your grace to say, honey, I love you. I see that this is something that you're veering on. I am with you. I am for you. I am praying with you. How can I help? This isn't leverage to come back on them and say, I told you so. This is your opportunity to be a partner, to be a friend, to be a prayer warrior to your spouse. I love you guys. I want to give you guys the best opportunity to succeed. This is where God is leading us as men of this church. Y'all are awesome. Could you please put your hands together one more time for him? Here's what I'm going to ask, just because it's going to be a lot of moving around, a lot of stuff like that. if you'll go back and sit down right where you were sitting, after we do our last few things up here, I'm going to invite all of you back up. There'll be a resolution image up here. I want to get everyone's picture after you've signed your resolution in front of your spouse or in front of your family. Okay? All right, while Mike and Raymond are lining these up, gentlemen, you'll find that your name is custom put on some of these already, so you'll just find the one that's yours with your family present. I want you to sign that joker, stick it in the whatever it's supposed to go in, get up here, get your picture taken, and go home and put it on the wall, all right? It's going to be good. It's going to be good. I'd like our ushers to please stand, come forward. We're going to receive this morning's tithe and offering. Heavenly Father, we love you. We have worshiped you. We've sat in your word and asked you, God, to just literally chisel it upon our heart. These men have come up, spoken very clearly of the intention of their heart and the direction. I ask, God, that you bless all of this. I pray, God, that it was received in your courts as worship. Bless our hands as an extension of this worship as we now give in the act of obedience of our life. In Jesus' name I pray. And everyone say with me, amen. Amen.
It's been a great day, man. I don't know about you, but my heart is happy this morning. It's full. It's warm to see the men take a stand and to see our children, see a full cycle here today, amen. So proud of our children, those that are pursuing God, those that have committed their life to Christ and are growing. And we're so excited and proud of our children's ministry. We're proud of our youth ministry. We're just proud of this church and what God is doing in it, because it's in him that we live, we move, and we have our being. Amen. It's in the life flow. So I encourage you, if you're not connected, you need to jump in the life flow and allow God to do some incredible things in your life. Just a couple of quick things that's coming down the pike that you want to be aware of is this coming Friday and Saturday, the children will be having a camp out here at the church. We will still have church Sunday because it'll still be standing. So Friday night, you could bring your children. If they're in our Kidstown Children's Ministry across the over in the FLC, you could bring them and drop them off at 5 p.m. this coming Friday evening. Make sure you're back Saturday morning by 9 a.m. to pick them up. And they're going to have a great time. This is for your boys and girls. The boys will be camping outside. The girls will be camping in the gym. So if you have any more questions, you could get with the Kidstown team, and they'll be more than able to fill you in with some details. You could also sign up back at the information center if you would like for your children to participate. It's free, so we encourage you to bring them and let them be a part of that. I know they have a great time. Also, we have we've created what we call the We Care package. These are care packages, and it's just loaded with goodies, some things that are easy to just pop out, some crackers, gum, applesauce. There's all kinds of stuff in here. I believe there's even a New Testament in here and a track, some things that we want to allow you to purchase. These are for $5. We have them back in the foyer. You could purchase these. Many times we see people that are in need, maybe on a street corner, or maybe you run across someone and you need to just show them the love of Christ. Oftentimes you're afraid to give them money. This is something you could place in their hand, and it would be nourishment to their physical being and their spiritual being as well. So I want to encourage you to pick some of these up and hand them out to people that you feel that are in need. And just be a witness. Be the hands and feet of Christ through the We Care package program here at Faith. Amen. All right, why don't you go ahead and stand with me today. I want to say a blessing up over you. And then, men, I encourage you to come up. We have the certificates for you to sign and for you to take your pictures as well. Let me pray for you. Lord, I thank you so much for your amazing love, your grace. Thank you, Lord, that we've been able to dive into your word through this Guardrail series. We thank you that we could see very clearly the parameters that you have given us, Lord. Give us the strength to secure those guardrails in our life that we may walk, Father, in alignment with what you have for us, that we may grow to show the love of Christ to those around us, and that we could take everyone with us on this journey of life in a safe manner. Father, I pray a blessing up over every individual here, every family. Thank you for what you're doing at Faith. God, we're so honored to be a part of what you're doing in your kingdom. I pray a special blessing in the wonderful name of Jesus. And everyone said, amen. At Faith, we do three things, and we do it with all of our hearts. We love God, we love people, and we love life. God bless you. Have a wonderful day.